Whenever I go hiking, I expect an encounter with God. I expect a transcendent experience. I expect transformation. And most of the time, not all of the time, but most of the time, it happens. I crave it. I thirst for it. Now, I can't speak for Brian and Charlie because most of the time, they are a ways up trail from me. Sometimes over the hill, sometimes where I can't see them. So context helps, I suppose. Most of our camping trips are in the desert because we do most of our camping in the fall and winter. We don't do snow camping. Besides, the smell of sage in that desert air, great expansive views in every direction, the color palette, there is just nothing like it. In my experience, the desert, which seems like a weird thing to talk about with all this rain, but these are the texts that we have, the desert is a place where souls are laid bare. I'm not usually one for selfies, but I took this commemorative one after reaching the top of a particularly difficult climb in Death Valley last year. And I'm honestly not sure which part was more difficult, the climb or the interior wrestling match that had been going on within me during that ascent. All of this came up in my mind when I read our text for today. I was especially taken with the first verse of the Exodus reading in chapter 17. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. That phrase, journeyed by stages, was immediately and deeply resonant. Isn't that the pilgrimage of life? Amazingly, Richard Rohr's daily meditations this week have been about pilgrimage. In this series, Wes Granberg Michelson writes, not all the slides are there, but so we'll keep it here for a little bit. He writes, embarking on such a journey, we become untethered not just from our physical normalcy. These uncertain, trusting steps also move us out of our spiritual familiarity. The pilgrim is not only invited to walk out of boxes of dogmatic beliefs, but also to walk away from practices of comfortable spirituality. In teaching on pilgrimage and preparation, Richard Rohr says, a pilgrimage can't just be a tourist trip. The meaning of a pilgrimage is an interior journey. Primarily, it's an interior journey enacted exteriorly. For those unable to make a pilgrimage, prayer labyrinths became an important symbolic substitute, a way of embodying that interior journey in an outward, exterior way. Rather than simply walking in circles, it is a journey to the center and back out again. Key to remember with prayer labyrinths is that it's not a maze. You can't get lost. There are no wrong turns. We are able to let go and trust that each step will take us closer to the center of the labyrinth and of ourselves, which is where God dwells within us. Because of this, pilgrimage offers a window to the soul. It is a way of praying, an embodied way of praying. A journey by stages, as described in Exodus 17. Exodus 17 also reminded me of the last several weeks of scripture readings. Jesus' temptations in the wilderness, talk about the soul being laid bare, and the call of Abram to get up and go to a place that I will show you. I hope you caught the order of things there. Get up, start moving, and then I'll show you where to go. But you have to start walking first. The wilderness, or the desert in the Bible, is a place to encounter God, and through that experience to be transformed, to journey by stages. The story from Exodus 17 is part of what is sometimes called the complaint narratives, or the wilderness narratives. It hasn't been all that long since their exodus and liberation from slavery in Egypt. And this isn't the first time on this journey by stages that God has provided directly for their needs. God has provided sweet water when the water was too bitter to drink, provided quail to eat, and some mysterious substance called manna. And now they've moved on from the wilderness of sin, but once again, there's no water to drink. And by the way, wilderness of sin here, sin isn't a moral description like the place where Israel sinned. It's the proper name of the place that has some kind of relation to the word Sinai and the meaning of thorny. Other words and images here in Exodus 17 are also quite evocative in the way that they play together. Moses fears that the people will stone him, that they will strike him with rocks and kill him. They complain and blame Moses for their thirst, and Moses then complains to God. And God tells Moses to take the same staff with which he struck the Nile, causing it to turn to blood, and strike a rock, and water will come forth from it. Not liquid death, but liquid life. Presumably, this is also the same staff with which he struck the Red Sea, or the Sea of Reeds, in order to part the water so that the people could safely pass through and escape from the Egyptians who were hunting them down. The water that comes from the rock, just like the manna and the quail and the sweet water and the passage through parted waters, are all signs of God's presence with God's people. The people end up wandering in the wilderness for 40 years before they enter into the land of Canaan. Numbers 33 and Deuteronomy 1 give an extended account for the reason behind this journey by stages that began with God's promise to Abram all the way back in Genesis 12, that he and his descendants would be a blessing to the whole world. We can be so quick to judge them, but the more that we learn about things like generational trauma, the more it makes sense that it would take several decades to unfold and unlearn old habits adopted during life under Pharaoh and begin to practice new ways of understanding and relating to God. Richard Rohr, in describing the way that pilgrimage has functioned across religious traditions and throughout the centuries, says, pilgrimage accustomed people to change and growth. Wandering in the desert for 40 years may seem like going in circles, which is going nowhere. So in addition to the image of a prayer labyrinth, insert an image in your mind, which is not here, I think, of a nautilus, which is a chambered snail of sorts. I don't know that a snail is actually the right designation. Or maybe a spiraled staircase. What seems like going in circles may in fact be bringing us closer to the center, closer to God, rather like a prayer labyrinth. Through decades of wandering, the people continue to live on quail and manna provided by God, evidence that even in their wandering, God is with them. In our readings this morning, the Israelites aren't the only ones who are thirsty. Jesus is too. And where the Israelites are journeying by stages, Jesus is also on a journey. He's on his way from Jerusalem in the south to the region of Galilee in the north. Most Jews would go around the region of Samaria, but Jesus' journey takes him on a more direct path, crossing virtually every boundary that there is. A moment ago, we read part of this quote from Richard Granberg Michelson. The pilgrim is invited not only to walk out of boxes of dogmatic beliefs, but also to walk away from practices of comfortable spirituality. And we see this happening here in John 4, too. As Melly told us, there is no love lost between the Samaritans and the Jews, something of an old family feud. The Samaritans are a mixed race of people originating with Jews that were left behind in the Babylonian exile, mixed with a variety of people resettled in the region as a result of the Assyrian conquest centuries before. So they share some religious roots with the Jews, including observance of the Torah, or the first five books in the Bible. There's much, much more to explore in this exchange between the unnamed Samaritan woman that Jesus encounters at the well than we can explore in just one sermon. This text is an absolute treasure trove. But one important side note that I want to be sure to mention is that just as there's no moral reference to the wilderness, in the wilderness of sin, there's no reference to sin in John 4 either. It's certainly not the woman's fault that she's had five husbands. It's not like women have the right to initiate divorce. It sounds rather like she's been through the ringer. And honestly, I think it isn't always God who's obsessed with sin, but us. So reading Exodus 17 and John 4 side by side reveals a few points of interest. In Exodus, the people are thirsty, and Moses gives them water. But in John, Jesus is thirsty and asking for water. As for tools for acquiring the water, Moses has a staff, but the Samaritan woman has a bucket. And whereas a recurring theme in the wilderness narratives in Exodus is the question of where God is and whether or not God is with them, the Samaritan woman also asks about God's presence in the form of which mountain is the right mountain on which to worship God. So many trailheads and parallels that we could follow. I find it deeply intriguing that Jesus doesn't have a bucket. In Exodus, people look to Moses and to God to provide for their needs. It is a sign that God is with them. But Jesus, who himself is the sign, the embodied sign that God is with them, has this life-giving water, and he offers to fill what we already have. The Samaritan woman asks about the right place for worship, which is a question about where God is present, where God's Spirit dwells. But Jesus says that with this life-giving water, God will be present within her, welling up without end. Not just on a mountain, not in some holy place with restricted access, but within her and within each of us. Jesus says those who drink of the water that I give will never be thirsty. The water that I give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. And so I wonder what it is that we are thirsting for in our lives. And with what are we attempting to quench our thirst? Pilgrimage can be a significant part of our faith formation and the evolution of our faith. But along the way, we will get thirsty. Will we blame others for our thirst? Will we ask for what we need? Are we even looking for transformation or for just a quick fix? The season of Lent offers us the opportunity for another sort of pilgrimage, and it can help us get ready for Easter. May we be ready to accept the gift of the life-giving water that Jesus offers as we encounter him along the way. May it be so. Amen.